Welcome to Life Unrestricted.
This is your show if you're sick of living a life controlled by food and exercise rules, and if you're ready to learn how to accept yourself and enjoy the heck out of life. My gig is about body image, femininity, self-worth, and resilience. Come on, let's walk side by side as we slowly step out of restriction misery and unlock our true selves.
Your host, Merit Boxler, is a former national radio DJ, freelance journalist, speaker, and writer with a passion to make women feel good in their bodies. This is a show brought to you live from Switzerland.
Hey, lovely radicals. Merit here, but not really here. Before we get to today's interview, you will hear a generic announcement that will stay the same for the next few months, so bear with me. As most of you already know, I am currently offline for the next few months, as I have made the very hard decision to go to residential treatment for the first time at the age of 44. I don't know how long I will be gone, maybe 3, maybe 6 months, so who knows. All I know for sure is that the facility I'm going to is very, very strict with internet access and generally what we're allowed to do and what we're not allowed to do. And it was asked of me to really focus on my own healing and not continue, you know, doing interviews and working on the podcast all the time. So there's that. And as uncomfortable as this is for me, it makes complete sense, of course. Yet, since I have quite a backlog of already recorded conversations that I wouldn't want for you to miss out on, since my guests were such gems and you really just need to hear what they had to say, I had to find a way to bring them to you while I'm away. My decision was to record all the intros beforehand and get everything ready before I go so that I can post them whenever I can. We will see how it works. And because I don't know how often I will be able to check in on Facebook, in our community, or other social media, I have decided to let a group of great people take over for the next months ahead. So please don't expect me to post or comment as much as I did. I know I will be online only very infrequently, and I won't be able to respond to emails or messages. Just know that our community on Facebook called Life Unrestricted is in the hands of wonderful experts and generally great, kind people who know about recovery and who are there for you. So rest assured that the space will be as safe as it's always been. And who knows, just when you least expect it, I might be able to pop in and say hi every now and then. As I said, who knows? That's probably the phrase I use most frequently these days. Who knows? Who knows? I really don't know anything. So for now, all I do know is that I want to bring you all the episodes that I have already recorded. And once I run out, well, who knows? We will see about that when the time comes. As for all of you lovely Patreon supporters who are still willing to contribute to this show on patreon.com/lifeunrestricted, know that you are always in my heart and that I'm eternally grateful for your support. As I cannot give any actual shout-outs to the latest contributors anymore because these intros are pre-recorded, I just wanted you all to know that I love your support and that I'm super happy to have you. And for those of you who are interested, as I said, the link to my support platform is patreon.com/lifeunrestricted. Every pledge you are making is happening on a no strings attached basis, so you can cancel anytime. Thank you, all of you, for being you. And now, showtime. Today on the Life Unrestricted podcast, I'm so happy to share with you my conversation with Cindy Springford from Plastow, New Hampshire. She and I had this lovely talk a few months ago, and it's high time you get to hear it. Cindy's varied background includes being a personal trainer, a running coach, and most importantly, an eating psychology coach. She has been in the fitness industry since 1993, encouraging well-being and fitness with her clients ever since then. And you will hear what we mean when we say well-being and fitness. Many of you know Cindy from her Love Your Body Project Facebook page. Currently, she works from out of her home, coaching clients both remote and in person. And Cindy shares her background about her body image challenges, chronic dieting, disordered eating, and excessive exercise, and how she made peace with all of it through discussions, articles, podcasts, and with the media. So I'm very happy to share this with you. And I'm finally able to say, hi, Cindy.
Hi!
Thank you for doing this so spontaneously. You rock.
Oh, well, thank you. I think you rock too, which is why I didn't mind being so spontaneous today.
Man, talk about life unrestricted. And I can't wait really to dive in. And since you and I really only have known each other from each other's Facebook's presence, Facebook presences, it's high time that I get to know you a bit better. And in order for me and my listeners to find out who Cindy is, please take us back in time. What kind of memories do you have of being in a body when you were a little girl?
I remember feeling like I was never good enough as I was. I remember feeling like I just felt like there was something wrong with the way that I looked, like I just wasn't quite right. And I didn't really have much reinforcement around me to make me think otherwise. So it was kind of like an unhealthy self-image that I had for a long time, just trying to reach the standard that I thought I had to try to reach to be acceptable to other people. So it was difficult growing up. It was difficult doing all that stuff.
So it started at a really young age. You don't have any memories of, you know, being carefree in your body at all?
I really don't know. I had experienced some, I'm just going to say some trauma when I was a child, and that probably contributed to how I felt about myself and how I viewed my body. So I never really felt like everything was okay, if that makes sense. I never felt like I was confident or comfortable in my own skin. And I think that that's what led to all the years of the other stuff that I had to kind of wrestle with.
I relate to that more than you think. Because when we are traumatized as children, and I mean, it's hard enough as it is for women and men without any trauma history, but for people who have experienced one or multiple traumatic experiences, then it's almost impossible to feel at home in your body, is it? I mean,
exactly. It's almost like you're occupying the space that you don't feel is...
deserve.
Yeah, exactly. And it's not a good feeling, not a good feeling.
Yeah. So you had a trauma when you were a very little girl. And on top of that, you were raised in a dieting household, or how did that all play out?
Yeah, I actually grew up with a dieting mother. So it was very difficult because I never really learned how to have a healthy relationship with food. And I never really learned how to have a healthy relationship with exercise either, because she would kind of manipulate her food and her exercise, and she sort of used it as punishment. So I never really learned the whole principle of joyful movement, and I never really got to enjoy what I ate because it was always in secret. If it was something that I felt like I wasn't supposed to have, I would sneak it because I knew I couldn't have it out in the open. So it was very confusing. And then I was always wondering why I had to sneak food and why I didn't look forward to gym class and all these other kinds of things. And it just was very, very confusing.
How do you mean when you say she was using this as punishment?
Well, she would definitely restrict food. I remember because I have a sibling, my brother, who was always very lean and athletic. So there was always different kinds of foods in the house, but I was led to believe and I was given the understanding that there were certain foods that were okay for him to have because of his body, and
yes,
there I shouldn't have because of my body. So that was really hurtful, really hurtful.
Oh, yes, I understand that. Mm-hmm. So that started when you were 10 years old or even younger than that?
Yeah, probably about 10 or 11. It may have even been before that, but I'm more cognizant of that time period just because of a few events that happened around then. And I think I was about in the fifth grade. It was also at a point where my parents' marriage was starting to break down. So that was also contributing to the discord that I felt as well.
Yeah. And we feel responsible for all the failings that happen. And in the end, we try and make it about our bodies often. Mm-hmm. So you were already deeply scarred when you entered puberty, which is the double whammy for most women. How did that play out?
It was difficult because I was kind of developing this woman's body. And at the one time, I really didn't have this feeling that it was an exciting time. I didn't really feel like I was looking forward to anything because I was so confused about my body. I was confused about it because I was led to believe that it was the wrong shape and the wrong size. But yet, because I was so young and because I was developing, I was getting that kind of negative attention that you don't really want to get from men. And that was also very confusing to me. So it was a very tumultuous time, and I didn't really feel like I could talk about it with my mother because her body image was so skewed. So I felt like I was looking to her for mentorship and I was looking to her for an example. And unfortunately, I got an unhealthy one. I mean, she did the best she could, obviously, but that's just what she was and how she felt about herself. And I mirrored how she felt about herself.
Oh, I so feel with all that. And I suppose you were also always feeling ashamed in your body. I don't know whether that's true. That's just me presuming. But I remember when I was a kid, I never found anything good about my body. I looked to other girls and was dreaming to be them and to look like them and maybe make my mother proud or maybe make my father care or something like that. And that was the narrative of my entire life. And especially in puberty, when some girls get all the attention and others don't, and you just adopt this idea that something is wrong with your own body and you go to war with it. Mm-hmm. So did you start dieting on your own then already when you were in puberty?
I believe it was a behavior that was easy for me to adopt just based on what I had watched growing up. It was a very interesting situation because on the one hand, I had learned that there was something wrong with me, obviously. So I had to manipulate my food intake and I had to try to shrink myself away in order to be acceptable. But on the other hand, I kind of rebelled against that same construct because I was angry that my mother and my family didn't accept me for who I was. Even though I didn't accept myself, I was more mad at them for not accepting me. And that's what would kind of get me to almost get into a little binge at times. And I would sort of push back against the whole dieting thing because I just wanted to be normal. I just wanted to eat like a normal person and I just wanted to live like a normal person. And every now and again, I could only torture myself and abuse myself through the method of dieting for so long before I just kind of cracked a little. And that's when I would sort of go off on these little, they weren't huge binges, but they were big enough where you would notice that something was going on.
Yeah, that's what happens to all people who are restricted in their eating.
Yeah. So
did you develop an eating disorder?
I wouldn't say, I mean, I think in some degree, a lot of us do have disordered habits. So I'm almost reluctant to say that I had a diagnosed eating disorder, but I definitely would try to, quote unquote, purge through moving my body for hours and hours at a time. I would definitely try to limit the food that I ate. And I was just under the impression that the less I took in, the better I would be, even though, of course, you know, the second half of the day I was ravenous and hungry, but I tried so hard to ignore my body signals. So my body was not my friend, and I certainly didn't trust it, and I certainly didn't do what it needed to do to thrive. So I was definitely disordered in my behavior, for sure.
So you were talking about exercise being something you abused. And for me, that was also what started to happen, but very slowly only, because in the beginning, it felt pretty good. And I always had this weight loss goal in my head, so it became sort of an instrument, but it took me years to realize how very disordered it became. Mm-hmm. So how did that play out for you?
It's very similar, I think, to your story, because initially it was just all about the dieting. It was about controlling my food intake until I was about my late teens, early 20s. And that's when I quit smoking cigarettes. And when I quit smoking cigarettes, I was really, really panicking because I knew that I was going to try to replace it with food. And of course, I already had a shaky relationship with food to begin with. And in order to replace the habit of smoking, I took up aerobics classes. And after about a year of aerobics classes, I became an instructor. And I think that's when, even though, like you said, it was a good thing because I was, you know, I was kind of getting those endorphins and everything else. But then I realized, oh, if I just exercise more, maybe I can eat more and I can break even. But then it became this issue of I could never get that balance right. I could never exercise enough and I could never eat too little for me to feel okay.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes, yes, yes.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I don't know if that happened to you too, but what happened for me was that along the way, I got these messages of A, eating low fat, which I did, and I bought diet food, but ate double of it, which I kind of, you know, I made it my habit and I kind of enjoyed it. I'm like, yes, I'm doing this deliberately. I'd rather buy two diet yogurts, but have two of them than one regular one. So I gobbled up all these diet messages along the way, you know, how to cheat and how to suppress appetite. And I realized that this was also a thing that led me to, you know, instead of eating, going for runs over lunchtime to suppress my hunger. And I think it was from some weight loss company that I got the idea of, you know, you can save all your calories for whenever you want, but it is limited to a day. And so I got the idea that I'm just going to eat once a day, but I had the free for all and I would have to pay for that by exercising. That was really toxic. And I believed all this forever. And I thought it was a sign of strength, what I did. But it got more and more disorder. And the exact same thing happened to me, too. Like, I never got the balance right. And mm-hmm. exercise was never enough. And probably my eating was too much. And so that spirals out of control fairly quickly, but mm-hmm. not quick enough so that you notice that your life is going to shitters and that mm-hmm. your relationships suffer, because I don't know, maybe for you too, you get compliments all around in the beginning, right?
Mm-hmm. You do. And then you become reliant on that feedback from other people to feed your self-image a little bit. And
yeah, the empty hole in your heart.
Mm-hmm, exactly. Because that's what you hang your hat on. And that's what my mother taught me. Her only piece of self-esteem, I guess, came from trying to present a nice exterior. And she would spend hours and hours and hours with makeup and clothes and trying to shrink herself away because that was what she thought she needed to be loved. That's how she got love and attention, was her body. That's what she thought it meant. And mm-hmm. that's what I grew up learning, even though I knew that wasn't correct and it felt off to me. But that's what I learned watching her.
Did you adapt this crazy idea with food as well, that you only can eat once a day, but as much as you want? Or was it just that generally you thought you ate too much and you had to make up for it by exercising?
It was a little bit of both, but I think I became very regimented in my food intake. I know that I tried all kinds of different plans. Like you, I tried the fat-free and I tried the low carb and I tried, you know, high protein, and I did, you know, I counted points and all this other stuff. And then I remember distinctly eating like every 2 to 3 hours, because I'm thinking, okay, well, if I just eat like a few bites at a time, and then I just in another hour or two, I can eat a few more bites at a time, maybe I'll fill up more and it'll feel better. And I remember taking the last bite of a meal. Well, you know, what I thought was a meal at the time, I would take the last bite of my lunch and I would start counting the minutes until I could allow myself to feed myself again. And it was just a very sad time, because I think back on it and I had no idea how destructive I was being, and I had no idea what the damage I was doing to myself.
Yeah, me either. That's the advice we get everywhere from every magazine, you know, how to suppress your hunger and how to, trick your body and stuff like that. Even to this day, we're surrounded by this. So I never questioned it either. I just thought my body is broken and it needs to be controlled even harder. You know, this unruly thing wants to break out. I gotta really rein this in. And the more I reined it in, the crazier I got. But I never made the connection, never. I really never did. It was all about me being faulty.
Yep. Yeah, so, you were broken. You were the one that was the problem.
Exactly. Exactly. Basically, making my parents or my mother right that I was a fucked up kid, and I basically proved myself right. So, right. But I never made that connection either. So how did your exercise behavior develop or evolve?
It was when I became a certified instructor and I would take on all these classes, and then I started lifting weights. I said, oh, now I can lift weights and I can teach classes. And then I started running. So I said, oh, now I could run and I could lift weights and I could teach classes. So it became this thing like more is better. It's almost like I went from one extreme to the other. I went from not doing anything to having to do everything. And it became an obsession for me almost to just keep track of how many hours I was moving, how many hours I was exercising, and I tried to exercise more and eat less, and that just made me hungrier. But I was still on this quest to shrink myself away, and I said, well, maybe I'm just not trying hard enough. Maybe I'm just too weak, and maybe I don't have enough willpower, and I have to practice, and I have to get better at it. And I became very competitive in the sport of dieting and excessive exercise, and it became something that was important to the exclusion of everything else. I think that you made a comment about your relationships and how they can be affected by your behavior, and I can definitely see how small my world was when all I was focused on was what went in my mouth and how I could get rid of it through exercise. It was just a very small existence that I was living by doing that.
Yeah. Did you become fearful of going to parties or on holidays or stuff like that?
Oh, I certainly did. I remember going to the gym either in preparation of or in atonement for whatever party I went to. I remember having to buy shapewear because I wanted to give the illusion that I was this teeny tiny person. And I was so hypersensitive and so hypercritical of any of my perceived flaws that I couldn't bear to have the world see them. So I tried my best to cover them up and to present this acceptable package to the world so they would be okay with me, because I certainly wasn't okay with me. It was a lot of work.
Yeah. And the fear starts taking over because we always think that we must be doing something wrong.
Yeah, exactly. And I kind of followed in my mother's footsteps. I tried to present this perfect package to the world. And I tried to have my appearance be everything. And I tried to make that my calling card, and I tried to put all this importance on it, thinking that if only I could get the perfect body, if only I had the perfect face, if only I had the perfect everything, then I'll be loved and I'll be accepted and I'll be approved of, and then I can love myself and I can accept myself and approve of myself, which of course now I know how backwards that is, but I really believed it at the time.
So how did your relationships to other people develop in those years?
It was very difficult for me to be comfortable with my intimacy with my husband because I was always worried about how my body looked.
Were married already?
Yeah, I got married when I was in my late 20s, so it was probably about 8 or 9 years into the exercise portion of what I was doing. But I started dating him when I was 23, so he kind of saw all this stuff that I was doing to myself with all the running around and all the, you know, limiting my food and trying this fad and that fad. And, you know, to his credit, he was very long suffering, but I'm sure it got to him too, because he couldn't bear to see what I was doing to myself. It was very hard for him to watch.
So he wasn't one to encourage it by, you know, telling you to go harder.
No, he definitely wasn't. And I have to say, one thing about him is whatever shape I was and whatever size I was, he always loved me no matter what. And that was another thing that was hard for me to accept, is how can you even love me? What is so lovable about me? Because I've always been given the impression that I could not ever be loved because I wasn't right. But yet he thought I was right.
Yeah. So many women get into abusive relationships, just as with their food and exercise, believing that that's love when someone gives them attention that is tied to conditions.
Yes, yeah. Exactly. So and I had my fair share of those before I met him, so I definitely didn't know what a healthy relationship looked like. So that was confusing also.
So despite you meeting him and having an accepting partner, it all got worse.
It did, because no matter what he said, I didn't believe it. And until I believed it, and until I could see myself the way he saw me, it was never going to matter.
Yeah. Tell us about those years.
It was tough because, again, I had still been dealing with some of the effects of the trauma from my childhood, which was obviously affecting my relationship. And I had just bouts of self-hate and self-loathing where I just withdrew and I couldn't really be present and I couldn't really live a full life because I was so mired in all my imperfections and I was just so trapped by my own fear of just allowing myself to be happy. And I didn't know what that meant because I was so busy trying to destroy myself that I couldn't really understand what it was like to just live a normal life. And even though that's what I wanted, I didn't think I ever could. I didn't think that I was capable of doing that because of all that I had lived up to that point. So that was a challenge for me. And it took a very long time for me to work through all of that and to realize that I was worthy and I was deserving. And it didn't matter what had happened to me and it didn't matter what other people said. I just had to make peace with it. And it was up to me to do that.
And I guess it takes a long time to even realize that we're destroying our bodies because mm-hmm. at the time I would have been in denial about that. I would mm-hmm. have said, I'm not destroying myself. I'm taking care of myself and I have to do this because that's the culture we live in and, you know, some other excuse to keep me busy in this cycle.
Yep. And what was even worse is because of the industry that I was in, the fitness industry, I was a quote unquote inspiration to people. Oh. And I'm dying inside, mind you, but I'm an inspiration. So I'm like, okay, well, at least I have that going for me, you know, and they have no idea what's happening, obviously. But
so yeah. You never tied it back to your actual trauma?
No, not at the time, because I think I got so good at talking about what had happened to me like it happened to someone else. And it wasn't
yes.
until, yeah, exactly. You know what that's like.
Yes, totally.
I was so good at telling the story. I had completely separated myself from the event and I never allowed the adult part of me to make peace with it and to heal. I had to comfort the little girl that was traumatized. And I didn't do that until I was probably in my late 30s. And that's when I just had my little spiritual awakening that doubled as a little minor breakdown. And that's when I finally said, okay, I have to figure this out. And yeah, it was a tough time, but.
So it was from your mid-20s until your late 30s that you basically ran yourself into the ground? I mean.
Yeah, it was difficult. I started getting into the exercise part when I was about 21 years old. And that led to probably another 15, 16, 17 years of the yo-yo dieting, the chronic dieting, the excessive exercise. I kept that up for a very long time. And when I finally sort of realized that I had to deal with this trauma because it was affecting my relationship, but it was also affecting my health, my mental health, that's when things slowly started to turn around. And I started wondering, you know, maybe there's more to life. I remember saying that maybe there's more to life than presenting the perfect body. Maybe there's more to life than having the perfect diet. Maybe there's more to life. And maybe I can stop hating myself just for a day and see what happens.
Did you reach rock bottom or how did those years, you know, develop?
I think the catalyst was having that little meltdown when I realized I needed to comfort the little girl that was hurt. I think that was the start of it. But turning 40, I have to say, that was the turning point for me because that was all of a sudden when I said to myself, all right, now it's time to learn how to be an adult because I almost felt like I was just self-destructive and I was this little girl kind of having a tantrum and I was kind of beating myself up and I was doing all these immature things instead of saying, now I'm 40 years old, I've lived all this life, I've got so much to look forward to, it's time to step into my own power and claim my worthiness and really focus on the things that matter. Because at this point, the dieting and the exercise just didn't feel good to me anymore. I had done them for so long and it's all I knew and I knew it was going to be difficult to get rid of those behaviors. It was going to be difficult to break up with this dysfunction, but it was like being in an unhealthy relationship, which is exactly what it was. But I was so tired of fighting and I was so tired of of hating myself. I really was. I was so tired of just fighting myself at every turn, and I just didn't have it in me anymore. And maybe that was part of getting older. You sort of learn how to let things go a little bit. And that was something I had to let go of because it was just killing me.
What did you realize first? That your relationship with your exercise was disordered, as in, oh, I have an exercise addiction? Or did you realize that you wanted to eat normally again?
I think it was the food part first, because I kind of took all of 2012 to learn how to eat like a quote-unquote normal person. I made the decision that I was going to break up with dieting, and I was never going to go on another diet again. I found a couple books that really changed my perspective. One of them was Intuitive Eating, which was phenomenal. And the other one was Overcoming Overeating by Jane Hirschman and Carol Munter. And between those two books, and taking a lot of time for self-reflection and just being alone with my thoughts and being alone and feeling the fear and doing it anyway, because I was scared out of my mind, because I always had something to fall back on. I always had the exercise to fall back on. And, you know, if things just went south, I would just find another diet to go on so I can have that temporary honeymoon period again. And I had hope that things will turn around. Well, I was giving those away. I wasn't going to do that anymore. I had to learn how to do something else. So reading those two books and allowing myself to feel those fears and to sit with the anxiety, but still realizing that it was something I had to learn because I wasn't getting anywhere doing what I was doing. So what did I have to lose in learning how to do something else? And that's kind of how it started.
And how did that look like in terms of food? So you did the food part first, which probably brought up all the weight gain fears.
Mm-hmm. It certainly did. And I, because I also was still personal training clients and I was still working in the fitness industry, I had the Lycra spandex wardrobe, which of course, you know, was kind of stretchy. So I was just deciding, you know what, I'm just going to live in yoga pants and this kind of thing. And I decided I had to start where I was. And I said, I'm not going to measure. I'm not going to count. I'm not going to micromanage. I'm just going to do the best I can. And I expect to go a little nuts. I expect to eat more than I need. I expect to select all the foods that I had been depriving myself of for so long. And I was ready to deal with the consequences of doing that. I was ready to accept whatever my body was going to do in response, because I knew this was the only way that I was going to get better, is if I just let myself do it.
So you didn't fall for the intuitive eating hunger and fullness diet, you know, where people fall into the trap of, I'm only supposed to eat when I'm really hungry and I'm supposed to stop when I'm full and, oh my God, I think I'm not hungry yet, or did I, and all that stuff, you know, the I shouldn't emotionally eat diet.
Yeah.
You didn't fall into those traps?
I think I entertained a little bit of that, because I am also a recovering perfectionist, which, you know, can sometimes be a real pain in the neck.
But I don't know what you're talking about.
Yes, you know.
Yeah, I totally do.
You know, it's such a common story. And I think that, again, it's just sometimes it's the price you pay for being female in this culture. You know, it really is. There's just so much pressure on you to be everything. But I think that I was so determined, because that's the thing, is if you have a strong enough purpose, you can accomplish anything. And for so long, my purpose was to get by in as little as possible, to burn off as much as I could, and to shrink myself away. And I was so driven to that purpose that it was nothing for me to do that. But then once that became no longer feasible for me to do, and I got so tired of it, and I hit my rock bottom, like you said, then I was driven by this whole new resolve, and I had a new purpose to heal myself. So all that energy that I had put into being self-destructive, I now channeled into becoming whole again and healthy.
So how did your eating look like in those early stages of recovery? Because in all the groups that I belong to, I see and I understand, I see women freaking out. Like, I'm hungry all the time. And for me, that, you know, only cranked up my exercise even more, because when I started to eat more and during the day, I got so afraid that I exercised even more. And then I got afraid and then I stopped eating during the day again. And it was all back and forth and back and forth because I was scared shitless of my own hunger because here it was and it demanded food. And all my head said was go exercise instead of eating. And all my body said was feed me, feed me. And then when I fed it 2 hours later, it was feed me again. And I'm like, I should be exercising. What's wrong? And I see women left and right freaking out because that reinforces the belief that our bodies are out of control. So please share your experience with us in a little more detail.
Well, I definitely was afraid at first. It was interesting because I was euphoric in the beginning because I'm like, wow, all the things that I've been missing out on, I can finally have. And then again, I was gripped by this panic, like, you know, what do I do to shift the balance and how do I make it all work? But I just kept coming back to this thought of I have got to get this under control. I've got to figure this out. I can't go on like this anymore. And I know it's going to be uncomfortable. I know it's going to be hard. I'm going to have moments of doubt. But if I don't do this now, when is it going to happen? Because again, there was something about just being 40. And I said, I don't want to deal with this nonsense anymore. I have got to get rid of this nonsense. And I dealt with the food part first, but I was still kind of doing my exercise. I was running a lot and I was lifting weights a lot. But I was so focused on getting the eating part figured out that once I did that, that's when I dealt with the exercise. So I didn't do it all at once. I was still kind of exercising, but I was trying to heal the mindset behind the food first. And then once I started getting a little momentum and I just reread those books and reread those books and reread those books, probably by the end of 2012 is when I kind of broke up with all the exercise that I had been doing. And that was probably as hard, if not a little harder, than the food part.
Oh, I bet.
It was really difficult because I was still working in gyms and I was still training clients. And I would go to the gym all day and I would kind of put people through their paces, but then I'd go home and I'd sit on the couch and do nothing.
But how did you know that that was what recovery actually is? And how did you know that going crazy with food is actually part of the process of healing and that reactionary eating is all part of the process? How did you know all that?
I think reading those two books gave me a lot of insight, and I would recommend them to anyone because they were life-changing for me and also life-changing for a lot of the people that I've worked with. But it just, it's almost like it resonated. Did you ever like come upon a book or come upon something that you heard it and you saw it and you're like, wow, I've done this before. This just feels right to me. I can relate to this. This just speaks to me. That's kind of how it was. It was like, I found it. I found the Holy Grail. I found my answer. And even though I was so far gone, it felt like it's something I can do this. I know I can do this if I just practice it and if I just read it and I just pay attention to what this book is saying, I know I can do this. And it's going to be hard, but I'm willing to try. And I was just so ready. And I think that's also what it was too, is I was ready. I was ready to move on with my life. I was ready to take the pause button off because I had put my life on hold for so long, locked in the self-imposed prison of dieting and exercise. I was ready to break out of that. I was ready to see what the world had to offer me. And I think that those books, those two books that I mentioned, were the catalyst for me having my own reflection, because I would just, instead of exercise, I would only move when I felt like it. And that meant just walking around the block, take a walk around the block and just sitting quietly with my thoughts and allowing myself to go through all the roller coaster of emotions that I would go through. Because it's like you go through withdrawal, you know, I'm so used to moving my body 2 to 4 hours a day. And now I have all this extra time. What do I do with it? You kind of feel it loose ends a little bit.
Yeah, totally. There's two aspects of it. One part is that it's been a habit and that we've done that for forever and that it was really tightly related to what we deserved to eat or what we thought we deserved to eat. So when you stop exercising and eating more, then you get double the fear. Mm-hmm. And part two of the whole thing is that exercise was giving our day structure, or that was just what we did in our quote-unquote hobby, which when we boil it down to it, it's probably not really, but that what we made our hobby to be. And so when you take that out, there's the emptiness, like who am I going to be now when I'm not the fit chick? and what am I going to do with the emptiness? And part two of it is the fear of weight gain, which, I mean, it's not a coincidence that the first chapter and the most important chapter of intuitive eating is overcoming diet mentality. And that's the hardest thing. I'm still working on that. Sometimes I'm like, I don't know if I can get this internalized fear of weight gain out of my head. So I shoot myself in the foot with that. That's a big hurdle.
Mm-hmm. It is. And it's years and years and years of conditioning, and it's unlearning how to do all that. And that's difficult, because if you've spent, you know, so many years of your life practicing certain behaviors, it's almost like you need to practice new behaviors to crowd the old behaviors out. And that's what I learned, is I'm not going to think about what I used to do. I'm going to learn how to do something else and put all my energy into that.
Yeah. So it's what made you come to the point where you said, okay, whatever my body's going to turn into size-wise, mm-hmm. I'm fine with that. I need mm-hmm. to break my exercise addiction. I don't want to be the one who has to earn or burn food, and I'm going to nourish my body. Mm-hmm. Oh, how did you do that?
It was practice, it was time, and it was determination. And it was just the realization that this was not helping me, and I had to do something about it. And it was killing me, and I was tired of killing myself. I was tired of hurting myself. I was tired of thinking that I wasn't good enough. I was angry. I was angry at diet culture for lying to me. I was angry at my mother for not accepting me for who I was. I was angry at all the crappy relationships I had that reinforced my poor self-image. And I just really got mad. And I think that that was part of what helped me, was because that fueled me to take my own side, because I was worth more than that. It was almost like I saw myself for the very first time. And I realized that, you know, you come into this world and you go out of this world alone. So you better try to get comfortable in the vehicle you're traveling in. And I was overwhelmed by this desire to just learn how to like who I was for the first time in my whole life. And I couldn't do that if I was going to continue to punish myself with dieting and exercise. I couldn't do it. So even if my body shifted, and even if it got bigger or if it got smaller, if it stayed the same, you know what? That's how it's going to be. And I had to learn how to radically accept this could be my life forever. I could get bigger, I can get smaller, but no matter what shape I take on, I'm still the same person. And until I accept that, and until I learn how to deal with that, the outside's not going to make a big difference, because I hung all my hopes on the outside, but I had to get to know the inside. And I was on this mission to get to know who I was and to really like who I was. And that was more important to me at that point. It finally became more important to learn how to like who I was than to try to get smaller.
What did you do in those first stages of recovery? You just allowed yourself to eat, and you said, okay, I'm going to walk around the block, and I'm not going to be obsessive about exercise, and I'm going to see what happens.
Yeah, I did. And I had those books with me. I really did, especially the Overcoming Overeating one. I had a highlighter, and I marked that sucker up, and I underlined the passages that spoke to me. And whenever I started to question what I was doing, I would pull that book out again. And I would look at it, and I would read, and I would remember all of the pain that I had endured through dieting and how it was such an empty pursuit, and that there was hope for me, because if other people could do it, why couldn't I do it? And I kept going back to that same point. So whenever I felt like I was starting to lose my momentum, whenever I started to feel like I might creep back into those old habits, I pulled that book out again, and I reminded myself what got me started. And I think that was the big thing, is I had to really remember how low I got. And I had to remember what that rock bottom felt like. And I had to allow myself to hope that life was more than that. And that was what I was going for. I was going for more of living and not just existing, because that's what I was doing. I was just kind of existing. I wasn't really living life to the fullest. I was just kind of shrinking myself away, and I was tired of it.
Totally.
Yeah.
And most women experience that, you know, only when the body starts showing injuries, stress fractures, all that sort of thing. it's only then that we start to realize that our exercise behaviors and our eating behaviors might not be so beneficial mm-hmm. to our bodies, even though most women do all of what they do under the guise of, I'm just trying to be healthy.
Yeah, exactly. And it became this lie that I believed. I really talked myself into it. But all those years of all the exercise and, you know, preaching and living the lifestyle and saying all the things that I was doing, it was just to practice my self-destructive behavior. And I can say that with a straight face. I mean, exercise is great in the right amount. And, you know, eating fruits and vegetables is great, but not to the exclusion of everything else. And if you can find some harmony in the middle, and I know moderation gets a bad rap sometimes and it's overused a little bit, but I really believe it's possible to learn how to be more moderated in your day-to-day living if you just practice. Just practice. It takes time, and you're going to fall on your face a bunch. I know I did, but it's just getting back up and trying it again and taking one day at a time and just allowing yourself to make the mistakes, but giving yourself the grace when you make them and realize that your life's not going to end just because you ate when you weren't hungry or you did something that fell outside the parameters of this new system that you're learning. Because you're right, it's very easy to turn the intuitive eating system into a diet because it becomes all about black and white. And if I don't follow it exactly, then I'm a failure. But it's just a framework for us to learn how to reconnect with our own bodily signals, which is important because we were made to know when we were hungry and when we were full. But because of all the years of dieting, we've become so disconnected from them.
Yes, yes. Totally. And I think what's important and what I hear all of my guests say, and you as well, is that what I often fall into is the thought that I should be able to go from, you know, crazy behaviors around food and exercise to moderation directly. Bam! And what I hear all my guests say is like, no, this pendulum swings to the point of moderation. But unless we are willing to surrender control and let the pendulum swing to the other side, and as you said, go crazy with food and basically let ourselves rest and heal, mm-hmm. then there's no moderation to be reached, because then that's a forced moderation and that backfires again. I mean, with me, when I'm trying this and I'm I'm totally guilty of that, then the binging doesn't stop. Because I'm still totally restricting.
Exactly. And you just have to realize that these things are going to take time. And because that's a hard concept for us to grasp, it's not easy to practice that. Because why do we go on diets? Because it promises an end result in X number of days or weeks. So we're not used to having this open-ended, uncertain path. Because, well, if we go on this 21-day challenge or if we do this 30-day whatever, this is how long I have to restrict myself. But then there's a light at the end of the tunnel. I can do whatever I want. Whereas if you're going on this new journey when you're trying to learn how to just live a balanced, moderated life where you don't count and you don't measure and you don't obsess, there's really no finish line. You do it forever. And that scares people because that's just normalcy. It's not a diet. It's just living.
Mm-hmm. And we have to find out who we are also, because we can lose ourselves in this promise of, you know, get your happy identity or your fit identity from all the diet advice out there. There's always this imperative of physical improvement that is attached to the promise of being happy. When, how did that develop for you? You know, asking yourself, who are you really outside of your whatever workout achievements or your body size.
Mm-hmm. I got wise to that after a while, because whenever I would set a goal or whenever I decided I wanted to change something, I would achieve it. And then all of a sudden the bar was higher. So it's scary. And that's perfectionism.
The goalpost moves all the time. Yeah.
All the time. So you can never really celebrate where you are because you're always trying to get somewhere else. And I did that also with running marathons. I had run 8 marathons in a 4-year span. That was the hardest thing, was when I had to stop running for a few months, because I had identified myself as a runner. And even though it was exciting in parts, and in the beginning it was innocent enough, but again, it turned into something else and it became unhealthy. But that was really difficult, because then when other people would ask me, oh, so when's your next race, or, you know, when's your next marathon, or how's the running going? I said, oh, I'm just taking a break. And then they would kind of hammer you and give you the third degree, because remember, I worked in the fitness field, so I talked to people all day long. And then having to have that conversation when you're still kind of trying this new behavior on yourself, and you really don't want to get into the whole ins and outs as to why you're doing it, because it's really, you know, no one else's business but your own. But it was very difficult for me, because I saw myself as a runner. I saw myself as a weightlifter. I saw myself as all these things. But I said, those are just activities. Who am I really? Who can I be without them? If I had to go without them forever, who could I be instead? Or what can I be instead? And that was where the real work started, because having to divorce yourself from these identities, it's very difficult, but it teaches you a lot, and it forces you to kind of rely on your own inner voice and your own intuition, because you get to know who you really are apart from those things. Because everyone has something, you know, everyone has something. It's that soul connection. You can call it whatever you want, but you are who you are apart from all these other things that you do. And it was about tapping into that that I think was really important for me. And that's what got me through having to be separated from these identities that I wore so well and so proudly for so long.
Is that why you tackled the exercise head on as well, and just basically sat and walked? I fall into this, you know, tricking myself into doing just a little bit more than yesterday, and I have to really watch out. So would you make a case for some abstinence in the realm of exercise for people who are having a hard time? Because it usually is the last hurdle. Women, when they stop restricting, they usually use exercise to, you know, have some semblance of body control, quote unquote.
Yep, exactly. And for me, it seemed like the right thing to do. It seemed like that was the best course of action to take. I guess you can say cold turkey when you just decide you're just going to stop everything. It's a big shift. But again, I was kind of on the fast track to healing at this point, because I was so determined to get my life back. And until I tried to work that piece out, because I wasn't injured. I didn't have stress fractures at all, but I was just tired. You know, you just felt like you had no motivation. You had no drive. I was still running all these miles and I was doing all these things, but they almost felt like I was duty bound to do them, but they didn't feel good anymore. So in a way, it was easy to make that choice, but in practice, it was so hard, because I felt like I was supposed to be doing it. And then it became a chore. It was a chore that I was engaged in. It was no longer joyful movement. It was a chore, because I was so regimented in doing this.
So tell me about the first, like, 7 days of not doing what you were previously regimented to do.
I'm like, I don't even know what to do with myself now. And I really tried to get myself scheduled to either see people, go out for coffee with friends, or read those books. Every time I doubted myself, I picked up those books and I read those books. And, you know, going to the gym and training clients, that was really hard. But I said, no, we have to stop everything. It's like I had to erase the chalkboard and start over again. And I couldn't do that until I felt like exercise was something I wanted to do instead of something I felt like I had to do. And until it became a want to for me, I just wasn't going to do it.
Wow. So how was your mental chatter in those, let's say, first few weeks of trying to break that addiction?
It was loud. It was really loud. And I questioned it a lot. But at the same time, I said, you know, I looked at it as I was in rehab. I was in exercise rehab. You know, I'm detoxing in a way, because I would tell myself that. I said, you know, this got out of hand, and this is not something that's helping you anymore. This is hurting you. And until this can be a positive method for you to care for yourself, it's not something that you should explore anymore. And it's hard, because, again, on the surface, it's healthy, but I had used it in an unhealthy manner. So I had to figure out how to reframe exercise in a positive light before I could add it back into my routine. So that's why the only thing that I would do, and it was only if I felt inspired, the only thing I would do would just go for a walk outside. And there was no watch. There was no trying to make it more intense. There was no power walking. It was just stroll, like really, really stroll, just to be outside, just to be in nature, just to be alone with my thoughts. And that was the only thing that sounded good to me at the time. So
even though the thoughts didn't sound good to you, you know?
Yeah, they didn't. But I said, you know what? Either I'm going to be anxious and exercising a ton, or I'm going to be anxious and not exercising a ton. Either way, I'm going to be anxious.
Good point.
So I might as well see if I can get the anxiety to calm down if I'm resting my body.
What comes up for a lot of women in that process also is that suddenly when clothes start not fitting anymore, they freak out, or it becomes a real torture to go clothes shopping. Also that we kind of sabotage ourselves by looking at the wrong Instagram accounts or following the wrong people and still, you know, watching health documentaries and listening to some self-proclaimed gurus that want to tell you that eating carbs is bad and eating gluten is bad and you should cut out all sugar and better cut out all fruit as well. And all the narratives out there that promise miracle results, and you know, we know better, but we still sort of read that and then we doubt ourselves. So how do you help your clients overcome this self-doubt?
I think what I did when I was going through it was I kind of spring cleaned my feed and I got rid of all the things that I thought would trigger me. And when I was doing that, I thought to myself, you know, this is kind of interesting. I wonder why there aren't, because this was back in January of 2013. I said, you know, I wonder why I can't find many pages that address these things that I've been dealing with. And wouldn't it be fun? And wouldn't it be good? Wouldn't it be therapeutic if I started a Facebook page and just told my story? I wonder if there's anybody else out there like me. So that's when I decided to start my Facebook page, my Love Your Body page. And it just started off as me just talking to people and just telling them how I felt about food and how I overcame all those years of dieting and how I overcame the excessive exercise and the lessons that I learned and the things that I learned about myself and how it was possible to change if you wanted to. And all of a sudden people started to respond. And it's great to see all the resources that are available now. And I love seeing this movement kind of grow a little bit. But I do tell my clients, you need to protect yourself and you need to take the path of least resistance and make this as easy on yourself as you possibly can. And you need to put boundaries up and you need to make sure that you're surrounding yourself with people that support you and that you're aligning yourself with people that have the same kind of ideas and mentality that you have. And you need to get rid of all the other stuff that doesn't support that, because it's not going to get you anywhere unless you do.
And that can be really hard when relatives or friends are still engaging in diets and diet talk and, you know, this terrible bonding habit that women have over talking negatively about their bodies and what they've eaten and their workouts and stuff.
It is. And even today, because my approach, obviously, and my work has changed dramatically since I've had my own transformation with how I feel about my body and about food and about movement. So my work with clients has changed a lot, and I'm attracting a different kind of client now, which is interesting. And we still have those conversations, and I still remember seeing a little bit of myself in each person that I talk to, because I remember being that person. I remember being scared, and I remember being insecure, and I remember feeling like I wasn't good enough, and I remember feeling like it was my fault, not the diet's fault. And I used my experience, and I don't ever want to forget what that was like, because I know that if I remember what I went through, then I can identify with what these people are going through. Even though I'm kind of on the other side of it now, I never want to forget where I came from, because it's important to use that experience to help others who are in that same spot.
That's so important, you know, to work with someone who gets you. That's extremely critical. And what I wanted to talk to you about was when you talk about making peace with our bodies. I mean, that's a huge topic. So how do you address that? And what do you understand is body image work?
The way that I learned it was, and this isn't for everyone, but this is one of the tactics that I learned from overcoming overeating, is I put myself in front of a mirror and I put myself in a bathing suit and I looked at myself in front of a mirror and I did my best to stand there and just look at myself in a non-judgmental way. And I did that for only as long as I could until I felt myself starting to be critical, and then I would stop. And then I would try it another day or two. I'd put that bathing suit back on, and I'd get in front of a mirror, and I would just objectively look at myself, and I would just see, I would just say what I noticed, what I was looking at. I would notice how my shoulders were shaped. I would notice how my waist was shaped. I would notice how my legs were shaped. I wasn't being critical. I wasn't pointing out quote unquote flaws, but I was just noticing and just saying, this is my body. This is my home. This is where I live. And this is what I'm going to make peace with, because this is where my life is right now. So until I make peace with what is, I can't go anywhere else. So until I decide I'm going to wave the white flag, it doesn't mean I have to say things I don't mean. It doesn't mean that I have to say, oh, I just love the way that I look and I'm so happy with my body and all this other stuff. But I can at least become its ally. I think you have to learn how to be an ally before you can be a friend. You know, I let myself be seen. And I let myself look. And I think that was a big thing, because I'm like, what am I so afraid of? And the more I looked and the more I allowed myself to be in front of that mirror, the less I found to criticize, because I had decided that I accepted it. I had to learn how to accept it before I could learn how to like it.
And I think you went one step further and you took a picture of yourself and posted it in a group. What was that like?
It was scary. It was really scary, because I was bracing for all the hate and I was bracing for the comments. But I have to say, it was such a positive experience for me. And everyone was so encouraging and everyone was so compassionate and positive about it that I was so glad I did it. Because I really think that just like sharing your emotional pain is important by telling your story, sometimes putting yourself out there, even though it's scary, gives someone else the courage to do the same.
Yeah, it happens in my group, Life Unrestricted, on Facebook too, when people post pictures of, you know, them feeling insecure about their bodies and posting them and having so many people cheer them on and saying, I don't see what you see. I see a wonderful person. I see shiny eyes. I see beautiful hair. I see, you know, something that we don't see. We are focused on our flaws all the time.
Exactly. And to sometimes see yourself through someone else's eyes is the gateway to learning how to see yourself in a more positive light. It's important to do that for sure.
And how do you help your clients to stop listening to all the diet advice that is out there and to all the health gurus and wellness people or even fitness professionals that tend to have this narrative of pushing weight loss in a sense?
I encourage them to seek empowerment in what they're doing. And I also try to provide a safe, supportive environment for them. And I let them know that they don't have to change their body one bit, and they don't have to do anything other than what they're doing now. They don't have to be anything other than who they already are for me to think that they're lovable and worthy and awesome. And each day we just meet the body where it is and we just do the best we can with what we have. And I do my best also to model that behavior for them, which I think is important, because it's easy to talk the talk, but you have to walk the walk. And I do my best to try to exemplify what it's like living in that non-diet universe and how much better it feels to just break free of all that stuff. And if people see that it's possible, and if people know where you came from and all that you did to get to that point, it gives them hope to do the same, and it gives them that strength and courage to try. And if you let them know that, yeah, it'll be up and it'll be down, but you'll do the best that you can, and the journey's not linear, and you just have to take it sometimes one meal at a time, sometimes one bite at a time. But I think it's also important to show them the failures, the repeated failures of dieting, and to almost have like an intellectual intervention with them at times when they kind of go off on things that they think that they're supposed to be doing. And you just kind of show them over and over again why this isn't working for them and all the things that they've done. It's just caused them more pain and suffering, and that every diet that they've gone on, they've just been more miserable than they were before they started. And allowing them to just talk and just holding space for them, because most of the time they'll come up with their own solutions. They just have to hear themselves talk.
Very good advice. If someone is extremely tied up in this idea of my worth equals my weight, you know what I mean?
I do.
Worth and weight are so attached to each other. How do you help someone detach those two ideas?
Well, I think what's important to realize is I ask them this question. I said, if you never change, if your body stays the same the rest of your life, what are you going to do with that? Are you just going to decide that you don't want to ever be happy again, that you don't want to go on vacation again, that you don't want to hug people and you don't want to wear pretty clothes? Because I think what people do is they say, I'll be happy when I'm smaller. I'll be happy when I have my eating under control. I'll be happy when. And yet they're putting their life on hold for something that may or may not even happen. So I asked them, I said, well, what would life look like if things were just the way that they were today? How would that feel? And we sort of explore that a little bit. And we try to see dieting for what it is. And it's hard for people because, again, if they're sucked in by that illusion of this is the answer that I've been looking for my whole life. But if you just look at where you are at this point and you just realize that your weight is the least interesting thing about you. It really is. It honestly is. But you have to kind of dig a little deeper sometimes because usually it's not the weight. People put all of their attention on the outside because it's easier than dealing with what's really going on in the inside. It's a clever distraction to avoid doing the work. And I think that that's why I was able to do what I did with quitting dieting and then getting my exercise under control was because I finally dealt with what was bothering me.
Which was the trauma.
Yeah. And then once that was cleared, then I can deal with almost what was easier in comparison, even though it seems like it wouldn't be because it was so difficult in its own right. But I had already I had already kind of dealt with my own demons because those were worse. Those were much worse. And then once that was out of the way, and I said, wow, look at what I was able to do. Look at how strong of a person I am. If I can deal with that, then surely I can figure this other stuff out. So instead of using your weight as your source of pride and self-esteem, realize there's a lot more to you than that and tap into that. And then once you tap into that, then dealing with the other stuff is easier by comparison. It doesn't mean that it's easy. It just means it's easier by comparison because now you really know where all the action is. You really know what's important.
Yes, and we live in a society that basically promotes this addiction to dieting, and it is, as you said, a really good distraction. As you probably know, I'm in trauma therapy for complex post-traumatic stress disorder that I endured for 1.5 decades when I was a kid, and that was eye-opening to see, or for me to put together after all these talks that I had, that it really is all a distraction. Everything that I do in me trying to make it about my body or my workout or my food is a distraction of the difficult feelings that are thereby suppressed because I'm busy all the time, you know, trying to make my body my project. So for me, it is extremely important to have my therapist and working on this trauma. And I believe it's not a trauma for every person, but it sure is a distraction from a deeper issue or a deeper hunger or a deeper sense of lack of purpose or lack of sense of worthiness or a deep shame of somehow feeling defective or not having been properly loved by parents that probably themselves were not properly loved. And that includes, you know, by describing all that, that basically includes almost everybody in the world.
It really does. Yeah, it really does. I mean, the woman that is on the endless quest for the, you know, the thin thighs and the small waist and all that other stuff is really trying to figure out, why aren't I a good wife? Why aren't I a good mother? Why aren't I this? Why am I so, you know, I think that that's where it's all coming from, is they think that if they get that under control, then they're automatically going to be okay and everything else. But it's a backwards approach. It's like you're working from the outside in instead of working from the inside out.
Yeah. And how are you ready in your work to hold space for whatever comes up, or how do clients even open up about what's beneath their dieting and exercise fears and behaviors?
I think it's because part of them know a little bit what I went through, but I really believe that it's because what I do I really think it matters, and I really care about it, and I really love it, and I really want to be there and help these women because of what I went through. I don't want anyone else to have to go through that. I don't want to see an 11-year-old diet. The thought of it breaks my heart. I don't want to see these women, these beautiful, strong, intelligent women, beat themselves up over a little cellulite on their legs. It kills me. It breaks my heart. So I want to allow them to feel like unconditionally accepting them and loving them for who they are. And I give them that every time they come in to see me. And then they trust me. And then once they trust me, they usually confide in me. And then once that happens, you know, there's tears and there's all kinds of things that go on. But I welcome it because that's when the real work can start.
Tears to me by now, because they're hard to come by for me. I have to fight for them, basically, yeah. And I see them as a sign for healing. So every time I can access a moment of past trauma, then I'm really proud of myself, because it is so much easier not to.
Oh, yes, I know. And you become, again, you become very good at being hard, you know, because you have to. You have to. You have to survive. So you fall into that survivor mode, and then you kind of shut yourself off. But, and that's another thing, too, is learning how to feel your feelings. I think you shut yourself off from feeling the painful ones. But what we don't realize is that when we decide we're going to numb the painful ones, we numb all the good ones, too. So if you want to feel the good stuff, you got to let yourself feel the icky stuff. And that's hard.
That's wisdom right there. It's true.
Mm.
That's so true. Mm-hmm. And you wrote a post about, you know, the sobering statistics of, I think I'm going to read it because I really, really, really liked it. You wrote, "Did you know that an estimated 20 million women have eating disorders? For every 100 women, 6 will be affected with either anorexia or bulimia. Did you know that the combined mortality rate from anorexia and bulimia is estimated at 20% for long-term sufferers? Researchers conclude this is the highest rate mortality for any psychiatric disturbance. One more sobering statistic for you. The American College of Sports Medicine reports that as many as 62% of the participating females in quote-unquote appearance and endurance sports suffer from eating disorders. While we spend countless hours complaining about this body part or demonizing that food group du jour, more than half of these women are slowly killing themselves. Friends, we need to do better. We need to model healthier behavior for the younger generations. There are young girls, 5, 6, 7 years old, out there watching how we treat our own bodies and listening to how we talk about our bodies. They will learn from our example one way or the other. They will either learn how to have a happy and healthy relationship with food, or they will learn how to live in constant stress and anxiety about it. Does this make you mad? It makes my blood boil." I love that. And you wrote, "Instead of spending our precious energy obsessively counting fat grams, calories, and hours of calorie burning exercise, we should be mad as hell that it's gotten to this point in the first place. And then we need to take our power back and become the person that we were meant to be, a whole, healthy, self-aware person, so that the next generation of young women can do the same. Eating disorders almost always start as a diet. I don't know about you, but that pisses me off." Cindy, I love you for writing this. It's just true.
Yeah, it is. It is. And it starts with us. You know, it's one small little thing that you can do. It's making that decision that you're going to tell your story. It's making that decision that you're going to do the best that you can with what you have. And once you do that and you allow people to see you and you put yourself out there, and then they say, "Wow, you know what? I can latch on to them, because, you know, maybe they can give me strength to get out of the situation that I'm in." And obviously, you know, let's be clear. I mean, eating disorders like anorexia and bulimia and certain things, those require treatment, and, you know, there's all kinds of stuff that goes on, and there are qualified therapists and doctors that deal with healing women that are in the throes of something that serious. But whatever stage you're in, whether it's, you know, that you just binge eat a little here, or you're dieting a little there, or you're kind of having a problem, you know, with the way that you look, it doesn't have to be that way. We don't have to be so focused on the outside. We don't have to be so shallow and superficial just because we live in a shallow and superficial society. We can rise above all of that. We can learn something new.
Yeah. What's one last word of hope you have for someone who's listening to this and maybe thinks, maybe what I'm doing is not really as healthy as I claim for it to be? What would you tell them?
I would tell them what I tell a lot of people and how I end a lot of my posts when I share things on my page. You are worth the effort. It's true. You are worth love and affection from yourself. You are worthy of all of that. You deserve to have a life that is full of joy and happiness and experience. And there's going to be some pain, there's going to be some heartache, there's going to be some tears, but you deserve to have that experience unfold for you. And you deserve to eat when you're hungry. You deserve to eat whatever you want. You deserve to be happy. You deserve to just kind of walk in the park and look at the trees and look at the animals and look at the birds and not try to count your steps. You deserve to have a life free of numbers. You deserve to have a full and happy existence. And I hope that you do that. I hope that you realize that you're enough just the way that you are, and you don't have to look any differently in order to have that.
And I want to add to that, you're also worthy of ridding yourself of toxic people in your life that might reinforce those old behaviors or that are giving you negative messages that you're not worthy. You're free to cut ties with those people.
Absolutely.
I had to say that. How can people find out more about you and your lovely page and your Facebook page as well, everything that you do?
Oh, well, if you go onto Facebook, it's facebook.com/, I believe, Love Your Body Project. That's the first page I started. I'm also on Facebook page Coaching and Training with Cindy Springford. That's facebook.com/coach, CYNDILOU, Coach Cindy Lou. And I do have a website that is in process. It's a kind of a evolving thing that I'm still working on tuning up, but that's loveyourbodyproject.org. So I've got all kinds of things there, little pearls of the day that I used to share a lot, and there's a little slideshow there. If you need a little quick inspiration or something that to boost your spirits a little bit, you can go there and check that out and look at all the resources that I have on there. And any questions, there's a method that you can use to get in touch with me. Just click the contact button and I'd be happy to talk to you.
And your snippets of wisdom are, I love them.
Yeah. Well, I also want to thank you, too, because you're doing great work with your podcast and with your Facebook group, and you're really providing a safe, supportive environment for women that are in various stages of their own journeys, and I want to thank you for taking up the charge and doing such important work. I really appreciate knowing you. It's been wonderful talking to you today.
I appreciate your words. Thank you so much. I have the final question for you. That is, what would you like to be remembered for?
I would like to be remembered as someone that cared. I would like to be remembered as someone that knew that she was worth more. It just took her a long time to realize that. And someone that was definitely here for a very important purpose. Someone that was here to help. Someone that was here to heal. Someone that was here to make a dent.
Thank you for doing this. It's wonderful talking to you.
It's wonderful talking to you too. I really enjoyed our conversation.
This was today's dose of badassery from Life Unrestricted. Find the show notes with links to everything we mentioned in this episode over at lifeunrestricted.org. And if this show is making you feel good, awesome, make sure to subscribe and please let others feel good too. By leaving a 5-star review on iTunes, you'll help make this show more visible and therefore more accessible for others. You're the best. Thanks.